I've had smart plugs for a couple of years now, but mostly to control my appliances that aren't otherwise integratable into a smart home ecosystem. However, after surging electricity prices, I started wondering how much I could actually save if I used them to take my devices off-grid during standby. After taking a couple of measurements from my most idling appliances, I came to the conclusion that yes, it does have a meaningful impact. So if you're like me and always wondered if the standby power consumption of your TV is really that bad, here's a video with a lot of numbers from somebody who has very little knowledge about how electricity actually works. Before we dive into the actual numbers, if you've never heard of smart plugs before, here's a brief explainer. These are essentially remote controllable power plugs that can be connected to your chosen smart home, like Apple's HomeKit, Google or Home Assistant, or even directly via Bluetooth with an accompanying app. There are lots of brands that make these, but I ended up with the ones from Philips Hue. Previously I used the IKEA Trot-Free plugs, but I kept running into issues like delays and unresponsiveness until I eventually replaced them all. There are of course other options as well, like this one from Eve, which includes a built-in power meter, and I believe they even sell an entire power strip. Other brands probably too. I have this setup in two areas of my home, the office where I spend most of my days working, playing and editing YouTube videos, and the living room where I wind down after all of that. For the measurement, I bought a Bluetooth connected power meter, in particular this one from Boltcraft, which simply shows the power draw in wattage. For clarification, I live in Switzerland, in a canton which is kinda like a state, best known for its terrible drivers, but that's besides the point. What matters is the power cost and how the billing is set up. Over here we basically have two pricing models that change four times throughout the day, and depending on when you're using electricity, you'll be charged accordingly. For example, the numbers for 2025 are as follows. From midnight to 7 AM, it will be 24.14 cents per kilowatt hour, and then from 7 AM to noon, it will be 30.41 cents per kilowatt hour. It then changes three more times, but essentially there are two high-priced periods throughout the day, and for the rest and the weekend, it's low-cost periods. That's in Swiss francs, mind you. Technically they're not called cents, but Rappen, but I'm going to spare you from any more Swiss currency pronunciations in this video. Meaning I'll be using the word cents and bucks instead of Rappen and francs, simply because it sounds really off in English if I do so, and I hope I'm not going to get shot for this. But as a little goodie, did you know that our version of bucks is called Stutz? Well, now you do, so feel free to impress your local sonite with your newfound cosmopolitan lingo. Anyway, as mentioned, I will be focusing on standby time, in particular the time from 11:30 PM to 7:30 AM, which is when I'm in my charging cradle and nothing is being actively used. That means we have 7.5 hours for the low price model and only half an hour for the high. I do realize that this is simplifying it a lot, but I will get to this a bit more later on. With all of these disclaimers out of the way, let's get some measurements done and see what we're dealing with here. Let's start off with my audio interface, the Arturia Audiofuse 8 Pre, a great box that I use to record these voiceovers with, as well as when I occasionally pretend to be able to play musical instruments. The Audiofuse doesn't actually have a power switch, it turns on the moment you plug it in, for better or worse. This means we have a permanent load of around 18 watts, or to get this into a format closer to the billing, that is 0.018 kilowatt in an hour, or kilowatt hours. If we take the previously mentioned standby period from 11:30 PM to 7:30 AM, the Arturia would cost me about 4 cents per night. Now, the cost per year is a bit tricky here. It is likely higher than just multiplying this number by 365, because the unnecessary standby time is higher on weekends or during holidays when nobody's home. But to keep things simple, let's just stick to the 365 days, which means we are looking at an annual unnecessary usage of about 53.58 kilowatt hours, or about 13.14 bucks, or stutz, which isn't too bad, but doesn't cover the cost of a single smart plug yet, at least not mine. Next up in my office are my monitors, the Yamaha HS7s. Although they do have a power toggle, it is located at the back, and reaching for it is something that I honestly never bothered doing. They each draw 11 watts, or 22 combined, which is 0.022 kilowatt hours. Over the same nightly period, that makes 4 cents, or just about 1576 for a year. Then we have my Apple Studio monitors. Again, no power switch, although this might be a bit of an anomaly. Nonetheless, the Apple Studio monitors draw a little less with 0.0084 kilowatt hours. Double that because I also have two, and we end up with 1203 for the year. Next up is an interesting subject, the M1 MacBook Pro. Interesting because there's two states, fully charged and charging. So this is one of the measurements where I'm a bit unsure about what the actual usage is. What I ended up doing is simply checking the amount it drew while being fully charged, which was a tiny 0.3 watts, or in kilowatt hours, 0.0003. But keep in mind, it will charge every now and then to keep the battery loaded, so in reality, it's going to be a little bit more. An additional disclaimer here, some devices will actually run into issues when you disconnect them from power for too long. Doesn't matter if it's a smart clock or if you just simply unplug them. The MacBook Pro can be such a device. For example, after leaving it without power for a long weekend or when I'm on holiday, it'll be completely drained upon my return. Meaning, if I wanted to use it then, I would need to charge it first. This can be problematic in certain situations, so keep this in mind. Then we have the PC. This one is only in use when I'm editing and gaming, otherwise it's off. However, it still uses about 0.0018 kilowatt hours in this state, so about 129 for the year. Finally, it's the NAS, which is a bit of a weird case too. I used to leave it on all the time, but since power prices have surged, I turn it off as much as possible. So I only use it when I'm editing YouTube videos or holiday photos. But let's assume most will leave it on, which is how these were meant to be used anyway. So during normal operation, my Synology DS1621 Plus uses about 0.066 kilowatt hours. Now, after a while it actually powers down the hard drives and goes into some sort of a semi-standby state, but I didn't notice any difference here even after leaving it idling around for about half a day. But I'm not sure they actually entered that state at all. I somehow fear that because I rarely have it running, it tries to index and work on the files whenever it can, so this number might be wrong. But to keep things going in this state, it'll cost me about 13 cents for the same nightly period, or 47.28 for the year. However, an additional disclaimer on the NAS. Most will have a multitude of power settings, including mine, so I could even set it up to shut down automatically during the same period and turn it on again in the morning, so you don't really need a smart plug at all for this. Actually, a smart plug is a bad idea in general here, as killing the power to a NAS is a very unhealthy thing to do, so don't do this. But I'm still going to add it to the total sum, even though it doesn't really concern power plugs, because it still matters as an extra cost for a device that doesn't need to be on all the time. If we now add all of these findings together, we end up with a yearly usage of about 365.73 kilowatt hours, or about 89.72, with the NAS taking the biggest chunk out of that pie. Keep in mind though, in reality the number is likely higher. I am limiting this to the same period for the weekends, but if not unplugged, these devices will use even more unnecessary power during those times. For now, let's move away from the working space to the entertainment area that is the living room. The living room is occupied by the TV, AV receiver, Apple TV and Blu-ray player, as well as two gaming consoles, the PS5 and the Xbox Series X. Both of them have different power modes, with multiple sub-options to preserve energy, but before we get there, let's quickly sum up the rest first. The AV receiver uses around 0.004 kilowatt hours, the Blu-ray player about 0.0002, while the TV is the highest with 0.022 kilowatt hours. I am going to exclude the Apple TV with its 0.0018 kilowatt hours here because that one needs to run all the time as it's the hub for Apple's HomeKit, which I use, so without it, automations wouldn't run at all. The standby time for these is also a lot higher than for the devices in the office. Most likely they are not needed for most of the day and only start to be useful in the evening or after office hours. For me, the most common scenario starts again at 11:30 PM when everything is shut down, but unlike the office, the living room only starts getting used again at around 8 PM on the following day. During a work week, I also turn on everything for a short period during lunch, before an automated shutdown happens after 2 hours. Why 2 hours? Well, it's not because I lunch for that long, I wish. The reason is I couldn't set up a 90 minutes window in HomeKit for some reason. And the 90 minutes window is because of the TV, as it likes to take its time to boot up. So even though I go for lunch at noon, for safety reasons, the automation is triggered around 11:30 AM. Taking all of these numbers into consideration, we end up with 7.5 and 11 hours on low and high cost periods respectively. Meaning if we combine the receiver, Blu-ray player and TV from before, we end up with 176.92 kilowatt hours or 47.20 for the year. Not everyone likes this setup though. The TV, for example, really takes its time to boot up, as just mentioned, and I worry that this process might actually harm it. You see, I have a Sony AF8, which is an OLED TV that came out in 2018. OLEDs tend to develop burn-in over time, especially if you have icons or other fixed elements displayed for a longer period. To combat this, most will have some sort of a panel refresh function that runs in the background whenever the TV thinks it's time to do so, and while, you guessed it is in standby, which means it's not happening anymore if there's no power. So far I haven't had any issues, but then again the living room automation was just recently set up. Only time will tell if this was a bad move on my side. But worst case, I can run the panel refresh manually, which does take a while and is a time that you have to reserve, which is the same for the next two culprits. The PS5 and Xbox Series X both have two power modes. You can either have them shut down completely or have them in standby mode as well. However, standby has certain sub-functions that can be enabled or disabled. For example, on the PS5, you can decide if the USB ports should supply power and if it should remain connected to the network and automatically update and download games. These are cool features. For example, I've had plenty of moments in the past where I told it to download a game while I was still on the run. Coming home to a freshly installed title feels quite futuristic, but it requires power. So if you disable everything, it uses as little as 0.0003 kilowatt hours, which is fantastic, but with all network functions on, it's about 0.001 kilowatt hours, so about 180 per year. If you also charge a controller, it's even more, but since I never do this, I'm not going to include this in my list, but if you're curious, this was about 0.007 kilowatt hours. It's a similar case for the Series X, however, there is another option here which I only discovered while making this video, a function that is supposed to learn your schedules and adapt its power settings accordingly. This is pretty cool, but it's not something I had enough time to test, and I'm also not really playing the Series X at the moment, so it couldn't really learn from my current behavior. The Xbox is also really transparent about its consumption and tells you right there in the settings how much it'll draw, and Microsoft even has a page detailing the power consumptions overall. Pretty cool. My numbers, however, were all over the place. Regardless of whether or not the network functions were on or off, it kept jumping around between 0.6 and 28 watts, even after leaving it on for an entire night. Maybe the 10 to 15 watts Microsoft states is an average of this. I don't know. The PS5 initially seemed to do the same. It would draw more power right after the shutdown before settling in on the 0.3 watts. When being shut off completely though, the Xbox was closer to the 0.5 watts that Microsoft advertises, with mine idling around 0.6, which is again very low and very nice. So if you're being conservative with your power settings, you don't really need to hook these up to a smart clock, but you will have to accept the fact that you might end up waiting for a game to be downloaded or a system to be updated every now and then. If you connect them to a smart clock, you also need to make sure to power them off correctly, otherwise you might run into some issues. However, they aren't really the problem here, it's the rest of the living room that will have you reach deeper into your pockets, especially the TV, but keep in mind, not all builds the same, some will use more and some will use less power. In general, all these numbers are for my electronics. If you're curious about your devices and don't have a power meter, it's best to check the manual or search online. But to wrap this whole thing up, if I combine all of my numbers, I'm looking at a potential standby usage of 650.69 kilowatts in a year, which is just over $165. By far the biggest power draw is the NAS, which I'm going out on a limb here and say is probably a less common item in an average household. Without it, it's just about 457 kilowatt hours. If we want to put these numbers into context and are a little daring by asking ChatGPT about factual data, we can learn that the average household in Switzerland uses between 4,500 and 5,000 kilowatt hours of electricity per year. However, this also includes heating and a lot of other appliances as well, some which I cannot directly change in a rented place. After a little bit of clarification from ChatGPT, I got the response that entertainment and office electronics account for about 5 to 10% of that, which means we are looking at most at 450 to 500 kilowatt hours, and that makes me feel like the biggest energy hog in the world. My standby time alone is 650 kilowatt hours. I don't even want to know how much energy I use during the day. I can only hope that the statistical numbers ChatGPT is referencing from didn't include people working from home yet, and definitely not those making YouTube videos. Still, even though I'm now responsible for single-handedly killing the planet, I'm glad this operation is doing at least a little bit of energy saving, and therefore reducing my power bills. But one must not ignore the cost of the power plugs themselves. At the time of recording, they are about $35 over here, and I have three, so it takes a couple of months before breaking even. And I don't know how long these will last, they might need replacement eventually. Considering the endurance of my other products from Philips though, I'd say I will have the earth depleted before that, so it doesn't really matter. Jokes aside, all of what I showed you here today is technically achievable without any additional devices. Nobody really needs smart plugs, but as a person who constantly forgets things, automation can be a big help here. I don't have to think about any of this anymore as everything is controlled automatically, and even if I forget to turn things off, I can still do it even if I'm on a faraway island. In case you are wondering, the Hue power plug itself draws about 0.17 watts or 0.00017 kilowatt hours and will cost 31 cents a year. I mean, what happened? In the end, these are my results to a question I had for a long time, but I'm even more curious about your thoughts on this. If you have tips, I'd be happy to learn about them. For now, I want to thank you for watching this video. I hope it was a little interesting, if not entertaining. Anyway, hope you're having a great green day and see you again in the next one. Bye.